our community. A number of our docents are here. If I told you how many hours of tours they gave and how many hundreds of thousands of dollars of value that would be, you would be shocked. But we can't thank the docents enough. We have friends, that are here. This has really, really been a banner year. In fact, the newspapers called me because they want some evaluation of the year. And the numbers are staggering, including the people that are watching via Facebook Live tonight. Those numbers have been amazing. People watch them again and again and save them up. So thank you very much for all the support. This has really been fantastic. We have not made a public announcement of the architect because we didn't want that great message to drown in the other great message of Botticelli, for which in the last week of the Botticelli show, I think I mentioned to you all, we had a guy in an editorial in Ripon saying this is the greatest art exhibition ever conceived in the Commonwealth of Virginia. So, you know, we got to be careful about plotting these things out. So thank you all very much. Please give yourselves a round of applause as we welcome John to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming. Tonight is apparently the most booked evening of the academic year. I'm just myself going to go on the provost's reception for faculty. But I see only one faculty friend pour themselves away from that reception in order to come, and very grateful. And I'll show my astonishing knowledge of PowerPoint. There we go. This is actually a banner which is outside, and at the top I wrote, as though it were streaming news, the Musgrove Museum of Art presents a third Thursday lecture by John Spike in connection with the current exhibition. And then there's an added little wrinkle. The artists who were in this room, as we said, Guido Reni, Agnolo Bronzino, Peter Paul Rubens, Paul Cezanne, and Annibale Carracci. The Cezanne copy after Tintoretto really is a wonderful example of the faith and trust we ask of you as we present to you these wonderful discoveries we've made of these works. They were all at auction with wrong names. And actually, I seem to be the last person left who has one of those plastic eight balls. But you can turn them over and an answer comes up. We don't need it. And we're going to get it. But there are also techniques involved. 35 years looking at original paintings by artists, learning their pigments and the supports they're painted on so that you can recognize them. In the case of the Cezanne, it's actually Aaron's good friend, the Italian curator at the National Gallery, David Allen Brown, who, when he came to see the Botticelli show, because he's an expert in Florentine Renaissance painting, he was enchanted by the pictures that I just showed to. He's on the committee for the Tintoretto show that Aaron spoke of between the academia, where the original of that is in the Academy of Venice and the National Gallery in Washington. And I hope they take the suggestion how fascinating it is to see what a great modernist made of their picture. So to return to the top of my paragraph, you do get confirmation. Usually it takes longer than the exhibition is still up, but you do get confirmation with a simple proviso. And actually, we wouldn't dream of doing things about which we're writing it. The idea of a connoisseurship comes from an 18th century word, connoisseur, which meant someone who could detect the quality of wines. And then we needed a word for someone who could judge the artistic quality relative between the works of art. And it acquired a second meaning, the ability to put the correct attribution or name on a work of art that's going under the wrong name or is simply anonymous. And this field, connoisseurship, on the wall text over there, I wrote, quoting an article of 2007 There's scarcely any aspect of our history today held in such ill repute as conversation. And only old gray beards who refuse to adjust still maintain an effort to do this. And yet, for us in a museum, actually knowing who did the works of art is not an option or a luxury. What would we be showing you if we didn't, if we thought that any single book had the final results or answers? It's not that way. And from the very beginning, it's only in this current show I'm talking about that we wrote on the placards the explanation of how one arrives to the correct identification. I'll talk about a few of those examples. But from the very beginning, we were doing this and just making the case. Who here was able to see the exhibition of Michelangelo, Sacred and Profane, in 2013? Almost everyone. Does anyone of that group remember this drawing here on the screen? The largest cartoon painting by Michelangelo existent. Well, none of you would have known that this work of art, which we put on the cover of our book, you see that's our book here, lower left, was not accepted as by Caravaggio. As a result of our show, is today one of our most famous works. This is the power of knowing the difference. And knowing the difference is, in fact, empowering to us. The reason that the great Bernard Berenson said that this could not be by him, and then everyone followed him, he thought it was by Giuliano Bujardini. How many people here have heard of Bujardini? Well, I don't know. It might be a historical coincidence, but the name means little liars. Have that as your family name carried around. You can believe the Bujardini. On what basis? At any rate, what threw them off was the child is so finely finished, and Our Lady, his mother, is so roughly sketched in. And they said, this disparity, shocking disparity between them is unacceptable. But that isn't really how you have to go about this. For example, all the black chalk lines of Mary, they're quite unrecognizable as his. And the finely polished surface of the child isn't so easy to find comparisons for, because he never worked so hard on any other drawing, except for a handful of his drawings he made as gifts for Tommaso Cavalieri. That's the reddish part is ground up red chalk, and the black is ground up black chalk. And the reason he was doing this was, this is how we presented this work, which was rejected by everyone. The reason he was doing this was the child is God, his mother is mortal. This is a commonplace of his philosophical. It's constantly requested for exhibitions. The credit for the beginning of a turnaround I want to give to a great scholar named Paul Joannides, recently returned from Cambridge. He contributed an essay to our Leonardo catalog. In 1981, we're reviewing an exhibition of Cosimo Rocchi Michelangelo drawings, and there it was, no feature particularly. He had the courage to say this drawing is sublime. And I wanted to acknowledge that he was a prophet in this case. And on the strength of that exhibition we put together, and there were other newly recovered works that had been rejected for decades, we got to participate quite remarkable acknowledgement for our college armies here in the Italian Embassy's Year of Italian Culture 2013 with a publication. I gave a lecture at the embassy. Now, we did a similar episode in connoisseurship in our exhibition, currently in Boston, and I hope everyone here saw the Monticelli show, and anyone who ever walked along James Road or Richmond saw this Venus's face very discreetly from the work. You never know who's in the back seat in the chair. And it will astonish some of you. Is that a previous book that considers this work an original work by Monticelli? And as I recently wrote to the director of the museum that it came from, and she wrote back expressing her heartfelt gratitude towards us as a result of giving it its proper context, that rather than an inferior version of the painting from which this figure comes, you know, he reused the figure from his famous Birth of Venus on the right hand side, he made it a different Venus. He gave it a different reading. The Venus, the beautiful picture that by Italian national law cannot be lent by the Uffizi, is an evocation of a classical sculpture. She is as solid and as rounded and as classic as the, it's called the Medici Venus that she's remarked on, whereas ours, by contrast, the Turin picture, she seems weightless. There's no attempt whatsoever to make you think you're looking at a sculpture. And in fact, the whole figure is rather sinuous. Her hair is tied up in this ancient Greek classical hair that was used for divinities. Doesn't have this wonderfully lush and sensual hair of the Uffizi version. She has what passes for a garment, I guess, that transparent top that would be great to be able to license it to Bergdorf to have ready for next Christmas, but you know, it doesn't belong to us. Well, this work was always considered, not by him, by some unknown follower, but because it doesn't do a very good job looking like the other one. That is not enough as a basis of identifying paintings. You have to look at the way the paint is applied, and you have to think about, well, what is the difference in the place that this was done in this artist's career? I always say there's no attribution without chronology. He did the large one just after returning from Rome, and that was in 1484, and did another picture in between, which is in the middle here, and that still respects the sculpturesque quality. So that comes in between the passage of years, and ours is very different later, probably around 1488. So to the classic, if you're my generation, question, will the real Botticelli or whomever be stand up? I think they're all by him. No one doubts the first one, but I will speak for the second one, which is in Berlin. But after living with the Turin one for 7 weeks, no doubt whatsoever, it's a very different picture. Just for you, your benefit, notice that the Berlin one, her face has some characteristics that make you think that it could resemble a real face, whereas the Venus is definitely, at the far left of the birth, is definitely a generic, idealized face. It's a certain sensuosity. You see her hair is wildly loosed. And by the time of ours, she's lost quite a lot of weight. Just look at the way her waist is cinched in there. She's, and this actually accordance with his spiritual thinking. It's actually far more spiritual than physically sensuous, like the other two. Now, here's a little bit of a trick. One of the reasons Mars, the Turing picture, has been slow to catch on is there don't exist any good photographs of it. In our catalog, in fact, the photograph that we have, which is the best available, looks rather like this. But in reality, she doesn't look as though she has just bathed in tomato soup. This is what she looks like in reality. We've all seen it, and she still has this pearly skin, which is of divinity. So we'll just delete that. And we'll see, doesn't she look better compared to the other ones when we remove the tinting there? And she's just thinking more spiritually, more philosophically than her older sisters. Now, when we had this work here, about halfway through in my guided tours, I started making everyone stare at her knees and shins. Many of you might recall. The gradations of tone in this are so fine that it is impossible to see, even at the distance of 3 inches, any sign that was made by the human hand. How appropriate for a picture of a goddess. Absolutely astonishing, these very fine gradations. And it was actually when I first discovered how he did it from our big banner outside, blown up 100 to 1,000 times. Actually, it's a series of extremely finely overlapping and interlocked parallel strokes, about 3 at a time, and from a distance. But even on top of it, he did it so thoroughly, you can hardly distinguish that. This is not the painting of an anonymous assistant in the workshop who did this picture and went blind. The only other possible theory, this superb technique is Botticelli's own. Another picture in this show, just to remind you, that was only found in 2006 in the sense, although it was in plain view for the last 50 years, nobody thought, it was explained to me, you would do a subject like this piece of things. It's got this wonderful backdrop of the Monte Lupo altarpiece in the photograph taken by Skip Rowland, our museum photographer. And I took this with me to Boston. And showed it to everyone so you could see how marvelous it looked with this background. Now, I'll talk about one of our cases here. That's this Nibali Pachu that's over on that wall there. And it's good to know the actual signs of things. This is a smaller than life size, the middle work over there. And it appeared at an auction as Studio of Van Dyck, who's an artist of the next century. And this is very tight and wired in a way. It's trying to be natural, but when you see a Van Dyck, you'll see what natural really looks like. Van Dyck was painted about 40 years later. And here's a picture on the left that went through the auction market. I don't know where it is, but someday they'll look at the video of my talk tonight. And then some will see this painting come up at auction, and they will get a Van Dyck, because this is a Van Dyck. And the reason they were so unsure about whether he did it is, you can just see the lines in the picture that make a kind of a square with a point on top. That is the original part of the panel, I can tell from the photograph. And all the part below that line, just below his white color, that someone enlarged it and made more of a picture, but of course it isn't as good as Van Dyck. And Van Dyck made this picture, I should say, based on this Nibali Pinocchio. In other words, as I show you all the evidence, it's very likely he owned this work because he liked drawing from it. And how else would he do it? And you'll see that in the Van Dyck, the hair seems more accidental and random than the hair is, and his skin seems leathery. And in Niebuhr, he's a Renaissance artist. He's the later 1500s. He can't distinguish the textures to this extent. He's already doing a lot, just taking a real model. It's been proposed that perhaps his model was blind. He did several existence studies of blind models. They worked very cheaply. And so this is probably one. And the man who sent that to us was the visiting past director of the Vincent van Gogh Museum in Holland. And he said, this is my favorite picture that you've shown me. I don't even care who did it. And I think that's a good approach to art. You should start first with Desert Moon here. And you see, here's a Van Dyck, an early Van Dyck. We'll be talking about this period on the next picture. And he used his head for this person who was mocking Christ in this picture, in the Prada of the Crown of Thorns. And it begins to see, well, it's very strange to mistake a late 16th century painting for a early 17th century painting. But it's the issues are so confused that a lot of people are unable to look at this work in isolation. The primary document is the object itself. Do not worry about a story that explains all these other things. If you come to understand it very, very deeply, you will have a very good story. On the way in, first thing who this looks like to you. He made another head, in fact, from it. This is another early Van Dyck. And notice, gee, you even ask yourself, why would people even confuse them? And yet, it's on the basis of the pose that people, retrospectively, said, this head must be by Van Dyck. But no, it's a typical work by Passerotti. We have works by Passerotti on the wall, photographs, so you can see, well, I shouldn't say Passerotti, it's the influence on Caracci at this time. We have works by Caracci on the wall, but I'm not going to show them all to you so as not to be too long-winded. And we're going to, gee, I was expecting the dramatic effect that you'd see this beautiful Rubens in the dark or half covered by the screen, isn't it? So, kind of just use your memories. This work came to an auction market, and it was called the School of Van Dyck, for reasons I'll show you. There's no known history, and so Aaron Graft and I looked at the photographs together, and we wondered what was happening here, what we thought. And this is wine. It was called Van Dyck, because, my goodness, this is a very famous picture. Left side. It was in an Althorp house for centuries in England. It's now belongs to a private collector. And I guess where it is on loan? The Museum of Fine Arts, Boston. And so we had a good look at it. And in fact, in the flesh, it doesn't look as much like art picture as it seems in these photographs, because what Van Dyck does. There's a very moist atmosphere surrounding everything. His hair seems honestly soft and moist. In reality, his face, his eyes are very, very moist. The Rubens is very much a work of art with a very lively human expression. Wonderful volume to the knuckles. That's a thing. Van Dyck is the prodigy pupil of Rubens at this date, about 18 years old, and Rubens has just returned from 1608 from Italy studying, and he has, you know, not done as good a job, the Van Dyck had left, not done as good a job with that hand as the Lily Bulging Rubens picture. Very important to our calculations, what might this picture be? I mean, since you've already heard a full example or two, you're semi-experts, you realize well, this thing on the right, why would you even say this was studio event? But that is, you know, how things happen. The auction houses don't have time to come through all the literature and so forth. One on the left is a well-known Rubens, and it's about his earliest mature style. So having it, it's clearly based on, you know, art picture, same source, by the same artist. Having this allows us to see very clearly what I suspected, which was that this is either Van Dyke thinking about young Rubens, or as we were going through the arguing, I started sort of saying certain things. This was just 2 days before the auction. And Aaron looked up from his computer screen, he was working on the computer, and he said, "What are you thinking?" And I said, "I think it is Rubens." And that's a very significant discovery and change. And so we had this one in Spain as a terminus ante quem. In order to twist people's arms so that they agree with your new attributions, you have to use Latin terms. I mean, while they're wondering, is that the same as post quem? While they're worrying with this, you change the same. Well, what it made me think of was that far right, there's this early Rubens. And the way to row on that shop, in order to do this at home, you know, I wouldn't say don't try this at home, try this at home. Remember how he painted that row. And now remember it for 5,000 days. It's exactly like the robe in our picture. And when he did this early picture of 1608, he was thinking about this great Renaissance artist named Correggio. And everyone knows this, it's painted. In fact, I put up the Correggio, and as I did this, I thought, you know, we probably should have put this Correggio up in our demonstration also. Look how close he's copied everything of that hand around the bar and the way that people look down and in profile and the upturned faces. I mean, it's an homage to this great Correggio. What Correggio did was he animated the figures more than anyone else in his century. For a long time, people thought he must be an artist of a later century. He makes the surfaces mobile, we say. They seem elastic. That makes them seem animated, more vivacious. They're not as natural as painting after Caravaggio and after Rubens himself. But you see how our picture could walk into this painting of 1608, and that's why we dated it in 1608. There's another wonderful thing about this painting, these very peculiar folds in the mantle. We didn't know what they were, but what mattered was all the significant parts. And as soon as the painting arrived, looking at it, it was obvious. And many people who have shown the picture recognize it immediately. That's his other hand clenching the mantle. But that's an ingenious thing, because pictures of sacred personages are not supposed to, you know, loop somebody's arms somewhere. It's supposed to have, you know, full set of arms and legs. This is how he's done it in this way. We go back to the Van Dyke, and he makes a mess of it. Down here, and I've just seen the original the day before yesterday and yesterday, and he didn't realize what the purpose or care. Anyway, he didn't do it, and suddenly, when you see this Van Dyke again, you see that, gee, yes, this early Rubens is animated. His face has all these wrinkles that real faces and skulls don't have. But it is idealized in a way that it's not natural, 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 like the Van Dyke next to it. The Van Dyke was famous because it even had this engraving made after it. And in the sales catalog, I'll tell you why the picture we bought was a studio work. the illustrated the engraving. Rather than wring our hands, we purchased it. And it's a great acquisition, this early Rubens for us. And in our recent researches, what did we find but a recently discovered Van Dyck and his proof? This Van Dyck on the left also. This is the last picture we'll talk about, the Cezanne after Tintoretto. And that's the largest picture on this wall. Saint Mark is flying to the rescue of a Christian slave who was being punished for his devotion to Saint Mark. And they're holding a whole public torture session of him. But as you see, especially clearly strewn on the ground, all the instruments of torture are exploded before they can be used against him. And this energetic scene of mingling volumetric figures enchanted Cezanne, who, even though he's not yet become a proto-cubist, still cares about making things seem solidly round and occupying space in the real world. Here is a nice picture of the Tintoretto, which is hundreds, 214, nearly 20 feet across. And it's a very beautiful picture by the masterpiece by Tintoretto that is not so strictly followed by Cezanne. This is the beginning. It's the second early picture by Cezanne in 1866 that I found. You need to know the chronology of it. You need to be able to date them. He doesn't have the same issues as the beautiful fabrics of Tintoretto and the exotic costumes are sort of jumping off points for Cezanne's imagination. Here they are together. And it's absurd, if you think about it, how much of the monumental picture this small painting, which is one, I don't know what, hundredth the size of the other one. Look at the figure, like a figure dressed in black, lower left. You notice, they look so much alike. In fact, he radically changed all the facial types to his preferred facial types. And there they are. And curiously, though this head is blown up so many times on the right by him, it's really an inch only, found a way to dab on it to recreate this very thick and pastel, that means thick applications of paint, of his style in the late 1860s. Here is another instance. At left, Tintoretto shows us basically from the head down, an elaborate foreshortening on the head of the soldier in armor who leans over. And this is not a muse. Cezanne, what he likes is his typical plaster forehead and dark eyes that you can't see. It changes the angle of the head, doesn't show us the top of it. So and forth. This is one of the most dramatic kind of changes. The face and the Cezanne has this funny appendage. The hands are so awkward, and these appendages stick out in ways that, as I studied them and studied them and studied them, have some time, because it's the second such picture by him that I came to identify. This is what I call, very scientifically, Cezanne's noodle nose. Here we have this pretty young lady in the Tintoretto, who we see, her bangs pushed over, and instead he's used this type that he loves, pasty face, slightly chubby cheeks, the eyes are sunken and dark, the volume of the head and the shoulder. It's all plastered on in a very pro-young, modern way. Remember, we're looking at a picture of 1864. It's extraordinary. Here's pretty much the pièce de la résistance. Now this chap who's leaning in, so we don't see his face, turns him into his uncle Dominic, this time wearing a turban. Let's see. This is his uncle Dominic. And you see, remember I said the highlights were all plastered on. And this is him. And we have on the wall here four more of these pictures of him the same year. And that is a useful thing for these beetling Browns. Useful thing for him to live in for us. For those who say, well, it's awful crude. The great Cézanne, because you're thinking of the mature works, which are so meticulously crafted. Here is a picture that is today in the Musée d'Orsay, but comes from his family house. He was painting in these same years religious subjects. And when he did Sébastien Belle Promo, look at the changes he made and people kneeling in limbo for the visit of Christ, who couldn't have seemed a little spooky. I mean, he's inventing the expressionism of Georges Rouault about 70 to 80 years early. And this is a painting in the Louvre, and this is what he made of it. The Magdalene and St. Mark, these were all important local devotions to him. Because the town from which he painted his famous mountain, let's say the name of Cézanne, Mont Saint-Victoire, is Saint-Marc and the church there. That's the little town from which he painted it. And the sanctuary of Magdalene is on the other side of Mont Saint-Victoire. He's another guy who does anything randomly. But Cézanne encouraged other people to think. That's why he became a recluse, that he was doing things randomly. This is an approximate style of painting that he has. We were lucky to have three outstanding technical and chemical assistants, Dr. Susan Buck, who did his paint samples, and Shelley Svoboda, who's the chief painting director at Columbia Williamsburg, and every semester I take my students to her, and Kristen Rustholz. They were intrigued by this process, and they produced a lot of material, more than I could ever show you, but which turned out to be very decisive to demonstrate that we're not talking through my hat. Something which I find comforting. What we see from all these layers, well, I mean, it's got several grounds. I mean, it's been painted over several times. He reused an old canvas, which is not unusual for him or for a young artist, and he also sometimes used machine ground pigments, which were good. He also did some hand-ground pigments. Some people still like to use them. This was a table made with a far right column and the miracle of the slate, it says. These are other published results of what the pigments are. And you see when you go over, it's all the same pigments that he used. Although we have one different one, which turns out to be, because these are later pictures, mostly, turns out to be rather intriguing. You see, courtesy of Colonial Williamsburg shutting, the shutting. You see that credit there? Because she could run all of these infrared IRAs. And so she was the first to point out to us and explain that there are figures visible underneath from the previous canvases underneath the surface here. And you'll see some back here through a thin spot in the back the man who holds up the noodle nuts, can you see that? Holds up the broken instruments to the slave owner, frustrating them, they all find it. And look at this x-ray, that's a whole standing figure. Southern Poo, I'm showing you the first set, and you all feel must be so, but it's just standing in the landscape. And he did such pictures with small figures in landscapes. Here it is. Thanks so much for coming to me.
That's cool.